the matter, babe? I can't get along with you. What the matter, babe? I can't get along with you. I can't quit you, babe. I've been put you down for a little while. You know I love you. Why don't you treat me right sometime? You know I love you, babe. Treat me right sometime. The way you treat me, baby, I'll drive a poor man mad. Unchain my heart, baby, and let me go my way.
Well, good evening, good evening, good evening. Once again, welcome to The Hood. I am your host, Reverend Alan Hudson, and I am so pleased and grateful and happy to be here with you once again on this Thursday night. I tell you all the time that it's really a blessing to me. It's really an honor to me, an honor for me to be here and to be viewed by you. Because I know that there's a whole lot on TV, a whole lot on the web, a whole lot going on that you could be doing, but you take time out of your busy schedule to watch us, and we're so grateful for that. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you have a daughter, call your mama, call your daddy, call your doctor, call your lady, call your preacher, call your teacher, call your police, call your crooks. Because we all make up the hood. Yes, indeed we do. We're just so glad to be here this evening. Sending our thoughts and our prayers to the brothers and sisters on the Gulf Coast. You know, well, it's now, I think, Tropical Storm Isaac is just dumping that rain from the Gulf. And, you know, burning around the hatches, as they say. And, you know, we there are a few lives lost in Haiti. But, you know, we're still praying. We've had some devastating summers in the past, and this one has been quite tame. So we're sending our prayers and our thoughts, especially to the people in New Orleans. You know, it's interesting how the storm is hitting almost seven years to the day. Not almost, they really are hitting 7 years to the day. Are we on? Amen, amen. So, we send our prayers to the people of the Gulf Coast, and we send our prayers for you. And we just thank you for tuning in, watching us. You know, as always, we send a shout out to my archbishops, Archbishop Dolores and Archbishop Ralph W. Eel, the very fine pastors of the Philosophical Institute of Religious Inquiry. Amen, amen. I mean, they are just wonderful mentors and wonderful teachers. And I tell you what, it just doesn't get any better. Just doesn't get any better than their teaching. We also send a shout out to my brothers and sisters of the Universal Hagar Spiritual Church. Reverend Laura Allen down there in Cochran, Georgia. and Reverend Nancy Brantley in Dudley, Georgia. Send a shout out to Princess Shirley Ada Akar in Hackensack, New Jersey. And we send also a shout out to our brother Matthew, Brother Matthew Johnson in New York. Amen, amen. And also shout out to our brother Elder Ray Neal right here in Atlanta, Georgia, Faith Memorial Church. So we say hello to those brothers and sisters. Now, let's see here. Oh, Love Storm, the CD by our own brother OG the Pen and sister Shazara is still selling. They're still playing it in Louisiana, and they really got a storm in Louisiana now. But it's really going well, and you can get that on CDBaby.com. Don't forget to go and visit iTunes, Brother Focus, Everyday Verbatim. These are some of our homegrown artists, and I mean, they are very good, very professional, and I mean, it's just wonderful music. Support your own is what I say. Amen. Amen. I think that about does it. We're doing a little different tonight. We've got the podium up here, and we're going to, you know, we always come to you sitting down and in a relaxed atmosphere, and we're still in a relaxed atmosphere, but going to try something a little different tonight. How about it? Amen. All right. Father, we thank you this evening. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for looking upon us up and down these dangerous highways and byways. Thank you for blessing our homes and blessing our families and preparing our way for us. And as we come now to do your work and do your will, we ask that you would reach down and touch us and give us what to say. We ask, Lord, that you would move us out of the way and you bring forth what you would bring forth. Amen. We have been talking off and on these past few weeks about, we started off talking about the book Madison. And of course, it's this book here by Dr. Scott Whitaker and Jose Fleming. And it's just an inside look at the medical and pharmaceutical industry and how it impacts you and me. And we started talking about that. And then we went from that to the healthcare situation in the country. And I think everybody knows, and I don't think anybody would deny, that in a nation as, I want to say a nation as great as ours, a nation that has so many people, and a nation that is going through the economic times that we're going through, we need health care because people get sick. And people can't always pay for the kind of health care that they need. And so that has been a big debate in politics, and you have your various talking heads on the radios and TV shows for or against. I want to start off, I want to tell you a story. I'm trying to make a point. Now, years ago, many years ago, two men were talking. And one man said to the other man, he said, I'm going on a vacation. I'm going to Australia. And I'm going to Australia. And when I get there, I'm just going to see all the sights I can see in Australia. The other guy said, well, that's good. He said, when you come back, be sure to tell me, you know, all the things you've seen. Bring me some pictures if you can. So the man left, and he went to Australia. Went to Australia, stayed for a few months, and came back. Another man said, what did you see? He said, oh, I saw a whole lot of wonderful things. They got a lot of things in Australia. They do a whole lot of things in Australia, man, you'd enjoy. He said, you know what? They got a lot of strange things in Australia, too. They got a lot of strange-looking animals. He said, you know, they got the kangaroo, and they got the all these different kind of poisonous snakes. You don't want to mess with them. They got all kind of stuff in Australia. And they said, you know what? You know what I saw? He said, I even saw an animal with a body like a beaver and a mouth and feet like a duck. And not only that, the thing laid eggs. The other man said, well, they must drink a lot of liquor in Australia too, because they know how I've done in the whole wide world. But years later, if you go in school, if you go to your science book, you'll see a picture of a duck-billed platypus. Now, the story that the man told and what he described was outlandish, but yet it was true. But it wasn't validated until somebody put it in a book and said that it's true. Now, in that case, in that particular case, somebody put something in a book that was true. But now, people also put things in books and on TV and on the radio that are not true. Case in point, in the 1996 Olympics, when Eric Robert Rudolph bombed the parking lot out there and killed some folks, for some reason, somebody began to focus their attention on a man named Richard Jewell, who was a security officer out there. And they focused their attention on Mr. Jewell, and then the media focused its attention on Richard Jewell. And before long, they were accusing him of bombing and everything else. As a matter of fact, they made this man's life a living hell. Then, when they found out that it wasn't him, there was no apology, there was nothing. But the thing is, because the media said that this man was guilty of doing the bombing or had something to do with the bombing, because the newspaper said, because the TV said, a lot of people believed that, but it wasn't true. There's a lot of things that people say about you and me. And I'm talking about those of us who everyday people. Now, there's a lie going around, and I say it's a lie that's been going around for years. There's a lie going around that certain people don't deserve to have anything. If you're born in a certain class, if you're born to certain people, if you're born to a certain racial or financial class, you don't deserve to have anything. You're not cultured enough to have anything. You shouldn't have money. You should just work and struggle all your life and then die with nothing, because that's the way it is. And oftentimes, people accept those things because of statistics in a book, statistic in a newspaper, or what they see on TV. There's another lie going around that says that if you love the Lord, alright now, if you love the Lord, if you're in the church, there's a lie that says that God won't let you have too much because you get beside yourself if you get too much. That's a lie. But it's a lie that people believe. And it's told by some to keep others giving money out of their pockets, and for some to get wealthy and others not. The lie is perpetuated by those who don't have anything and have bought it. Well, somehow I'll be a little holier if I have less money. I'll be a little holier if I just suffer for Jesus, honey. I'm suffering for Jesus, honey. But one day it's going to all be over, and I'm not going to be in hell. I'm going to be in heaven. And then I have all these nice and wonderful things that God's got to give. In other words, what you're saying is you don't want to go to hell, but you'd rather live in a hell here. Amen. Then there's a lie that says that, well, let's see, I got to die from something. I'm going to have to die from something, because life is such that you're born, you're young, and then you get old and sick, and then you die. You got to die from something. So if I get sick, I get cancer, I get liver disease, I get whatever, it's all in the plan of things. That's the way it's supposed to be. So if I can't pay the doctor, and if I have nobody to pay the doctor for me, well, I'll just go on to glory. That's the kind of stuff we accept. There's another lie that says that if you're smart in school, or if you endeavor to be smart in school, the lie says that for black people, you're acting right. As if, and this is a lie that's perpetuated on black people by black people. If you're getting your lesson, doing your work, you're acting right. But if you're acting out, then you're with the crowd. Attitudes like that keep people down. And then, there's another lie that says that, well, it's not a, well, on the surface, it's not a lie. Better to give than receive. But sometimes the lie is carried to an extreme. When you have some folk, you give, 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 give. You give everything you have to somebody else. And you give till you give out. And then you have nothing else to give. And when you have nothing else to give, all those folks you give to go and find somebody else. But they forget you. But somehow, we get the idea that that's supposed to be godly. Then there's another lie that says that all I have to do is pray every day. All I have to do is pray 24/7. And whatever I'm in, if God chooses, God will get me out of it. And if you don't choose, then I'll go on to glory. Brothers and sisters, do you realize that you don't have to go through life living without the things that you want? Do you realize that it's not a sin to have something in your pocket? It's not a sin to have a lot of something in your pocket. It's not a sin to be happy because you got something in your pocket. Do you realize it's not a sin to be healthy and wealthy and wise? Do you realize it's not a sin to be able to wake up every day and look forward to the day? Do you realize that? Do you realize that you have as much right to happiness right here on this earth before you die as anybody else? Look around you. Do you honestly think that all those people you see driving good, living good, you think all those people are devilish folk? Do you think all those people cheated and stole? Or do they just have a different outlook about life or about themselves? Did they just choose not to accept all the bull that somebody else put on them? Excuse me. Did they just not choose one day to get up and try to be the best that they can be? There's nothing wrong with being happy. I see a lot of folk every day. I see them every day going to work or going to whatever, and they got a frown on their face and singing the blues. And then they got a frown on their face singing the blues when they're coming back home. All day singing the blues. And the only thing that makes them happy, or the only time they seem to get happy, is when the weekend is coming. So glad that it's Friday. And then Saturday and then Sunday, then it starts all over again. The weekends are going to come until time stops. But is it an unreality? Is it really an unreality for every day to be a weekend? Think about it. What would it be like to wake up and look forward to the day? To look forward to going to work? To look forward to going to your business? To look forward to just to know what the day is going to bring? For many of us, it's almost like another world, but it's possible. But it starts right here. Our problem, well, let me put it this way. A lot of our problems, when it comes down to poverty. See, I have to say life is like a card game. You sit down, you playing cards, and somebody's dealing you a hand. You don't know what kind of hand you're going to be dealt. Some people are dealt a real good hand, depending on what kind of card game you're playing. Some folk are dealt a sorry hand. But whatever kind of hand you're dealt, you have to play that hand. If they deal you a real good hand, then you got to play it to keep it a good hand and make it an even better hand. If you get dealt a sorry hand, then you got to use your mind. You got to use strategy to turn that sorry hand into a good hand. That's how life is. But people, the people around us, someone we call our friends, people, many of them our enemies, people, many of them just doing what people do, talking negative. You can't get a job like that. You don't have enough education. You can't drive a car like that. You ain't got enough class. You can't live in a neighborhood like that because you come from the hood. And what about the hood? The mindset of people is that the hood has just got to be a place that's run down, dangerous, full of drugs, full of despair, and something to be away from. Well, the hood is like that because that's what people think and that's what people make it. Let me tell you something. Have you ever thought about this? You might know about a shotgun house. Y'all know the shotgun house. I ain't straight from the back, straight through. You may live in a shotgun house on a dirt road where ain't no grass anywhere. But you know what? The very fact that you live in that house makes that house special. I know people have known people who they live in what some would consider poor conditions. But wherever they lived, the old ladies, old men didn't have no grass. They take those old straw brooms, those old rye brooms, and rake that yard, and you have all kind of designs in the yard. They go somewhere and find flowers, and plant flowers, and make it a nice place. That's a matter of mindset. People, we have to change our thinking. You have to change your thinking. I'm telling you today that you don't have to accept life's condition. See, you come into the world, maybe you came to poor parents, maybe you came to rich parents, maybe you came with no parents. But the thing is, you're here now. And everybody has a mind. We can think. You hear me? We can think. And if you can think, you can imagine. Imagination is a wonderful thing. Imagination is a wonderful thing. Imagination is a wonderful thing. And whatever you imagine, you can bring into reality. Amen. Whatever you can imagine, you can bring into reality. You may not know how. You may not know when. You may not know where. But if you can imagine it, you can bring it into reality. You know, I heard a story once about Thomas Edison, who, you know Thomas Edison, we got these lights around here. Thomas Edison invented the first light bulb. Took him, I forget how, the experiments ran into the thousands, but he kept at it, and finally produced a light bulb. But Thomas Edison was a boy. Everybody thought Tom was kind of slow. As a matter of fact, his mother took him to, I guess, what would now be considered a counselor. And the man told her, he said, "Miss Edison, your boy just don't got it. Your boy is slow. He's just not smart. He's just not intelligent enough." The best hope for him is if you get them some kind of trade. But as far as higher loan, then now we don't have it. But the thing is, Edison didn't feel like that. I heard another story, another true story. A friend of mine told me this. When she was a little girl in school, there was this boy who was really slow. Now, he was slow. He was slow. And everybody used to laugh at him because he was slow. He couldn't spell, couldn't read, couldn't write. And so being the slow guy in the class, you know, our kids can be real crude. They would laugh at him. And he would go home to his mama. Say, "Mama, they're laughing at me because they say I'm slow. They say I'm stupid. They say I can't think." But his mama, like mothers do, his mother said, "Don't mess around. They don't know what they're talking about. You're the smartest boy in the world. Mama's boy, the smartest. You're the smartest kid in the world. You got as much sense as anybody. As a matter of fact, you got more sense than anybody else." And she told him that every day. You smart. Now, he was slow. But she told him he was smart. He was smart. So, he started trying to talk the way that he thought smart people talked. He started trying to act like he thought smart people acted. Started trying to look and dress the way he thought smart people dress. But on the acting part and trying to act like smart people acted, well, he started acting like he was studying. And the more he acted like he was studying, he started studying. And he started studying and studying and studying. And he actually got smart. And when it was all over, that slow kid was the smartest kid in class. Why? Because his mother told him something that he believed, and he took that belief, and he dwelled on that belief, and he worked that belief, and he made that belief work for him. It's all up here. So the thing we got to do is rearrange our thinking. It doesn't matter how, you know, we still got this thing after all these years, and I laugh, and I'm laughing ironically, because see, us African American folk, us black folk, us Asiatic folk, we still got this thing about color. I mean, you know, don't even mention the white folks. We got this thing about color. Is she light skin? Is he light skin? Is it blue black? Pecan, tan, brown. You're either not light enough, or you're too light, or you're too dark. We still make those distinctions among ourselves, but we got no enough to talk about somebody else. What some other people doing, we do enough to ourselves. Amen. But doesn't matter what color you are, how light you are, how dark you are, the thing is, what's up here? We got to change our thinking. You see, nobody has to end the way they began. It ain't where you start. It ain't how you start. It's how you end up that matters. A lot of people were born with nothing. Now, if you choose to have nothing, then, well, I mean, that's your choice. You know, Jesus said one time, you know, you always had a poor with you. Well, he didn't mean that everybody ought to be poor. But he just meant that as life is, you're always going to have poor people. Some people are going to keep on doing the things that makes one poor. You know, we was on a show last week, me and Brother Omari, and we were talking about the new shoes that are coming out, Brother LeBron James. The shoes that his name endorses. And these shoes are basketball shoes now. They're $315 a pair. Now, I know, and you do too, that if you're going to play basketball on these courts out here, you don't need a $315 shoe. You don't need a $315 shoe to play basketball anywhere. It's for style, okay? But now, if you're going to take the light bill money, and some people will do it and keep on doing it, take the light bill money and buy $315 shoes, well, you do that on a consistent basis, you're going to be poor. I mean, that's just it. But that's a matter of choice. If you choose to do the things that keep you poor, well, it's a free country, so be it. But what I'm saying is, if you choose not to be poor, you don't have to be poor. If you choose to be happy, you can be happy. But you know what? You have to make yourself happy. See, you know, I don't buy all this stuff. You know, I'm as romantic as the next person. I'm a romantic at heart, you know. I like a good love story. I like a good, Romeo and Juliet. Every time they run out of it, I like that. I like it when the guy gets the girl. I like that. But all this stuff about one day you're going to find the right one and that person is going to make you happy for the rest of your life, bull crap. Ain't going to happen. Because if you're not already a happy person, and if you don't make yourself happy, can't nobody else make you happy. Now you take that to the bank, you tell them Graham Hessen said that. You got to make yourself happy. And that's the problem with a lot of us now. We want somebody else to make us happy. We want somebody else to make us rich. Uh-huh. We want God to drop a pile of gold out of the sky. Why won't that happen? It ain't gonna happen. My mama used to tell me, she would say, you know what, boy? God give you sense. God give you sense to use to help yourself. Now, she would say, now, if you want to be a fool, that's on you, and God does you. But God give you sense. A lot of us act like we don't have sense. We do the things that are detrimental to our health, to our physical health, to our physical well-being, to our mental and spiritual health. You keep running into the same kind of men or the same kind of women. You know, you wonder why she's always doing you wrong and leaving you, or he's always doing you wrong and leaving you. Maybe you need to take an inventory of yourself. Take an inventory of yourself. What is it in you that keeps choosing the same kind of folk? See, it's logic. You hear it all the time, but it's logic. If all you ever plant is apple seeds, you ain't never going to get an orange tree. Okay? If you keep planting apple seeds and wondering why you keep getting apple trees, and wondering why you don't get orange trees, you are insane. We have to change our thinking. We as a people, really, we all people have to change our thinking. Because see, there's an opinion out there now that the so-called American dream is no more. Well, you know what? I believe in the American dream. You know why? The American dream is possible not because of the political system, not because of somebody else. The American dream is possible because of me, for myself. It's possible for you, for yourself. See, you are your own American dream. But if you stop dreaming, if you stop believing in your dream, then it ain't no dream. If you think that the system is going to make your life happy, make your dreams come true, forget it. It never was that way. I don't care how many episodes of Leave It to Beaver they showed on TV. I don't care how many episodes of Father Knows Best. I don't care how many Maxwell House commercials they ran on TV. I don't care what songs they played on the radio. It has never been true. The only thing that made the American dream possible was the individual, him or herself. But if you buy into this idea that happiness and health and wealth is only for certain people and not for you, you will never get your dream. Gotta change your thinking. Gotta change your thinking. Gotta change your thinking. And some of us church folk, you know, I call his name Reverend Lindsay Edwards. Reverend Lindsay Edwards. I don't know if he's still pastoring Mount Moriah Baptist Church in Macon, Georgia. But Reverend Lindsay Edwards, wonderful man, brilliant man. Not only was he a pastor, but he was a lawyer. But Reverend Edwards preached my daddy's funeral. And Reverend Edwards said something that I could just hug him for. He said, you know what? Some of these songs that we sing in church now, well, I don't know if they're singing it now, but they used to, like Lord, just build me a cabin in the corner of heaven. Reverend Edwards said, I don't want no cabin. We don't have enough cabins down here. Even in our mindset, when it comes to heaven, you go into heaven and you want to live in a corner in a cabin? Brothers and sisters, we got to change the way we think. We got to change the way we think. Getting back to health care. You see, I hope that everybody gets this book, Medicine. I hope everybody gets this book. Now, we're not trying to shut down the pharmaceutical. We ain't going to do that now. I mean, come on. I mean, you know, these folks been lying and cheating since before you and I got here. They be lying and cheating when we go. No, the thing is, everybody does not have to fall victim to the system. A lot of people will, but you don't have to. You see, a whole lot of people, when it comes down, so a whole lot of people have resigned to themselves that things not going to get any better, and that, you know, when they get to a certain age, well, I'm old now. You got 50 years old to mine. I'm old now. and my bones creak, and I know it won't be long, I'm going to be with the Lord. Well, people who think like that, let them think like that. But you don't have to. You don't have to throw in the towel. Life doesn't have to stop for you when you get 70 years old, when you get 80. When you get 90, life don't have to stop for you. You should always be striving for more, striving for higher, to learn more, to be more. To me, that's what life is all about. I really wish that I had known this, or I had listened when people tried to tell me earlier. If I knew then what I know now, then, you know, things would be different. But I'm not dwelling on what I did or didn't do then. I'm talking about now. Brothers and sisters, change your mind. If your health is not good, start studying, finding out about the herbs you can take, finding out about the things that you can do to make your body stronger. If you have an ailment, learn everything you can about that ailment, and then study the foods to eat. Study whatever, everything there is to know. You know what? We spend too much time worrying about dying. We don't spend enough time thinking about living. Start thinking about living. And not just living in health, but living in here. Think about living wealthy. You don't have to be poor. You don't. You don't have to go around in rags. You deserve to go around in the best, because God made you in His image and after His likeness. You deserve to go around in the best. You deserve to dress good, to drive good, to live good. And you ought to go around with a big smile on your face, thanking God that you can. Change the mindset. The American dream is still alive. You see, the American dream is alive in you. And you see, if you don't make your dream come true, then for you there's no American dream. It ain't got nothing to do with this system. It never had anything to do. That was just a smoke screen. But see, that's another story. But you see, for you, happiness for you is up to you. Happiness for me is up to me. We can be happy. We deserve to be happy. We can live good. We can be joyful and wake up every day looking forward to the day. You see, a lot of us, we don't want to go to hell, but we live in a living hell every day. We live a living hell. We choose to continue to live a living hell and then die and go there. Now see, I ain't gonna live in hell and die and go there. A lot of us waiting for heaven. A place to go to. I believe in heaven. I believe it is a place. I have my ideas about where it is, but I believe there's a place. But I believe too that I can experience heaven right here before I actually get to the place. I believe that. I know that's true because I see too many people doing it. Why can't you live in a mansion if you choose to, if you want to? Why can't you drive a Lamborghini if you choose to? Why does your church have to be a shotgun church if you want a nice church? And then, if you have a nice church, why should you be a butthole to everybody else? Why can't you be happy and welcome people in and let me and show what God has done for you, so I can pick up on some of that happiness. We got to change our mindset. We got to change our mindset. It's 2012, and yes, the economy is what it is. But to see, change your mind, change your circumstances. This is it. Welcome to our lesson, and this is the word. We have enjoyed it. Please join us next week. Remember, and the other part will follow. Peace and love. Bye bye.
I'm changing my heart, baby. And let me go my way. Unchain my heart. Mama, let me go my way.
Let me go my way. To happiness and peace.
Got to put up to live on in memories gone by. Hey! It's alright.